The films Gandhi and Tootsie led the way in Academy Award nominations earlier today in Hollywood.
They seem to want me.
That's right, they do. The biography of India's spiritual leader, Mahatma Gandhi, received the most nominations at 11. Tootsie, a comedy about an actor disguised as an actress, captured 10 nominations.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Among the other nomination leaders are E.T., which garnered 9. Next comes Victor Victoria with 7 nominations, An Officer and a Gentleman, and a German film called Das Boot got 6 each. Now, Gandhi and Tootsie are 2 of the 5 films named in the Best Picture category. The other 3 are E.T. the Extraterrestrial, Missing, and The Verdict. In the Best Actor category are Ben Kingsley in Gandhi, Dustin Hoffman for Tootsie, Jack Lemmon in Missing, Paul Newman for The Verdict, and Peter O'Toole in My Favorite Year. For Best Actress, the nominees are Jessica Lange for Frances, Meryl Streep for Sophie's Choice, Julie Andrews in Victor Victoria, Sissy Spacek in Missing, and Deborah Winger in An Officer and a Gentleman. Jessica Lange became the first woman in 40 years to earn nominations for both Best Actress and Best Supporting Actress. Now, not only is she in the Best Actress category, she is nominated for Best Supporting Actress in Tootsie. And along with her are Terry Garr, also in Tootsie, Kim Stanley in Frances, Glenn Close in The World According to Garp, and Leslie Ann Warren in Victor Victoria. The nominees for Best Supporting Actor are Charles Durning in Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, John Lithgow in The World According to Garp, Robert Preston in Victor Victoria, James Mason in The Verdict, and Lou Gossett Jr. in An Officer and a Gentleman. And come April 11th, we will all know who the winners are. And now changing pace a bit, here's a quick look at picking the flicks for the weekend. I can recommend Sophie's Choice, Without a Trace, Time Rider, Gandhi, and Tootsie. And that's it for now. I hope you have a nice movie-watching weekend. I'm Dino Lawley.
Thank you.
In 1959, Frances Farmer was the guest subject on Ralph Edwards' This Is Your Life. It was the last national appearance for the once radiant blonde star of 19 Hollywood movies and 3 Broadway plays. Her career ended in 1942 after she was railroaded by her mother into an insane asylum. Her tragic story is now the subject of a new motion picture, Frances, starring Jessica Lange in a performance the critics have already acclaimed as Academy Award caliber. She is now officially nominated for Best Actress. To prepare for the role, Jessica Lange spent 6 months researching Frances' life.
I did a lot of reading. I did a lot of talking to people who knew her. And then I just did a lot of work on kind of getting the emotional instrument ready for this role. And that took the most time.
While Frances Farmer's outbursts were the most emotionally draining to portray, it was the final chapter in her life, including the TV appearance on This Is Your Life, that Jessica Lange found the most difficult.
Were you Frances?
No, I was never an alcoholic.
Did you ever take dope?
Never.
Do you want to tell us what happened then, Frances?
Well, you know, I didn't think then, and I still don't, that I was actually sick, but there were so many people who seemed to think I was mentally ill that I just had to find out why and find out whether it was my fault, what was happening. You know, if you get treated like a patient, why, you are apt to act like one, and these things just pushed me a little too far, and it led to conflicts and strife with my mother. She thought I needed more care, and so she had me committed to the Western State Hospital in Washington.
Frances Farmer eventually moved to Indianapolis and for several years hosted a local TV show. She died in obscurity from throat cancer in 1970, leaving many who knew her story with one overriding impression.
That she had great talent, great potential, and great presence, and it was all wasted.
The movie Frances will be opening here in Oklahoma City on March the 4th. I'm Dino Lawley.
Got you on a 7-year contract. I'm planning long range.
Filled with human drama and suspense, Without a Trace does work as a film, although with some minor drawbacks. This is an important movie about the tragic results of children who disappear. And I must say, films like this one are oftentimes hard to review. The reason being is I might say something that could give away the ending, and I don't want to do that. In Without a Trace, a college English professor's 6-year-old boy disappears on his way to school. It's just a 2-block stroll, but he disappears nonetheless. Susan Selke is the professor, an independent and intelligent lady. She is portrayed by Kate Nelligan. Her husband, played by David Dukes, left her 3 months earlier and now is living with someone else. What follows after the boy disappears is mass confusion. The daily tabloids sensationalize the story. The police and media literally take over her house to work on the case, which is big news. Nelligan is interviewed many times, and here she first meets Judd Hirsch, who portrays Detective Al Minetti. He's the man in charge of the case.
What has been missing about
what was the boy wearing? Do you remember what he had on?
What was the boy wearing?
He had brown corduroys. He had on a dark blue jacket, pale blue scarf, and blue running shoes.
Mrs. Selke, has there been anything bothering Alex lately? Any quarrels or spankings or anything like that? Has he ever threatened to run away before?
No.
Miss Selke, do you mind if we take a look around the apartment?
No, please go ahead.
After weeks of little action and few leads, the police start to turn their attention to other cases. Everyone gives up hope except Nelligan. Stalker Channing, one of her closest friends, hints for Nelligan to see a psychiatrist.
Why?
But she is strong-willed and never gives up. Judd Hirsch, the determined detective, becomes consumed in wrapping up the case. He almost starts to neglect his own family. His own son is about the same age as the boy who disappeared, so Hirsch begins to worry even more. Later, a likely abductor is arrested, and Hirsch wants to close the investigation. But Nelligan refuses to accept that idea and plunges on, hoping somehow to see her son. Kate Nelligan gives a fine performance. She has a wide range of emotions, and we, the audience, can almost feel her pain and sensibility. We can trust her. Judd Hirsch also gives a very good performance. He's an impressive actor with tremendous depth. His character is a street-smart professional who can't completely remove himself from his work. All the supporting roles are well played out. On my rating scale, without a trace, rates a 7. The police and the press definitely have certain images to contend with in this movie. Most of the TV reporters are portrayed as exploitive. The police are portrayed in a more favorable manner. There are some unanswered questions that come up after the end of the film, and logic is sometimes defied. But other than that, a fine script, good acting, and directing by Stanley Jaffe make Without a Trace an important and provocative movie. I'm Dino Lally. Anytime a movie's advertising campaign or the production information says something like, so-and-so is a fictionalized account of a true incident, makes me a little weary. And that's exactly what it says in the film called The Entity. The actual incident allegedly happened to a Los Angeles woman in October of 1976. The film stars Barbara Hershey as the California lady who is being attacked and terrorized by some unknown and unseen creature. She's a single mother with 3 children. She goes to secretarial school and takes care of her kids. The creature attacks at different periods of time, mainly at night, though. She seeks help from a psychiatrist played by Ron Silver. He thinks her problems lie in her own childhood-rooted hysteria, that she just might be disturbed. Hershey then starts talking with some parapsychologists, and the battle starts between them and the more conventional psychiatrist. Here in this scene, Hershey talks with a group of psychiatrists from a nearby university.
Well, Dr. Snyderman explained it was like a very powerful dream.
Mrs. Moran, did you believe him?
I try to.
But you cannot. Why?
Because he hurt my son. He broke his wrist. Because my children feel it. Because of the marks on my body, they're in places I can't do it to myself, even in a dream.
Why does he attack you, Carla? Anyone else?
I don't know.
The rest of The Entity is pretty much routine. And as far as special effects, well, they're pretty standard, too. Although there are a couple of unique and distinct effects, here we see your basic poltergeist situation where the entity is bad and blows off some steam. When he talks, you can't help but listen. Barbara Hershey and Ron Silver's performances are believable, but as far as the other characters, well, they're just average. The Entity could have been a much better film with a more detailed script and tighter directing by Sidney Furie. On my rating scale, The Entity goes up to a 5. It's just your typical run-of-the-mill, mysterious happening story with nothing new added. The Entity seems to lose its identity at certain times, but still maintains an average effect on the audience. I'm Dino Lally.
William Styron's bestseller, Sophie's Choice, is one of those novels most Hollywood executives said would never translate to the screen, but they didn't count on Alan Pakula's love of the story. An award-winning producer-director, Pakula decided he wanted to make the movie the moment he read the book, and in doing so, he took a lot of risks. One, by writing the screenplay himself, something he'd never done before.
The most nerve-wracking running I had was running it for Bill Styron, because you're taking something from his unconscious and putting it into this objective form onto a screen. And it was also the most rewarding running I had, because at the end of it, he just stood up and he swept me up in this big bear hug, and he just said, you did it, you did it, you did it 100%.
Convinced from the beginning that only a European actress could portray the lead character of Sophie, Pakula took another big chance when he decided to cast actress Meryl Streep in the role after she asked him for the part.
You love her.
But when I took the chance, I was still very nervous about it.
No, not
because I never saw the character in Meryl. And the first day of reading, she opened her mouth and in the rehearsal, and that's the first time I saw the character. I felt the character. Something happened. She changed. The mystery of acting, the mystery of talent, and maybe in this case, the mystery of genius.
Considered as one of Hollywood's best directors, Pakula's key is in carefully selecting his actors and then making sure they thoroughly know their characters.
Contrary to what some people feel about directors, then we're not alchemists. And you cannot turn somebody who's untalented into somebody who's talented. You can cut your losses a little and make them look a little less bad, but that's about it. It is much easier for a director to hurt a performance than to help a performance.
And now that it's over, how does Pakula feel about his film version of Sophie?
As much as any film I've ever done, and maybe more so, it is the film I really wanted to see on screen.
Tomorrow, an interview with actress Meryl Streep. She'll be talking about how she prepared for her starring role in Sophie's Choice. I'm Dino Lally.
Terrific teacher who came to my house for 3 hours every day.
Meryl Streep, one of America's most acclaimed actresses and a four-time Academy Award nominee, is used to challenges, but both landing and performing the lead role in Sophie's Choice has been her biggest challenge of all. Not only did she have to convince the director to give her the part, when he was certain that only a European actress could play it, she then had to prepare by learning how to speak both German and Polish, and that involved several months of study.
I had a terrific teacher who came to my house for 3 hours every day and tried to walk me through the grammar. There are seven cases in Polish. Polish is set up like Latin. It's very, very difficult language, except it doesn't have Latin Romance roots. The most important part for me was to see how speaking that language made me move my mouth and how it changed my face and feelings.
In French, it's so easy. You say wit. Or in Polish, szybko, in Russian, bistro. It's not only in the English, it's so complicated.
The best thing, the toughest thing about it, and the thing that seemed to come the most effortlessly was the way she was emotionally.
I have to get back to the laboratory.
Why don't you stay and have some lunch?
No, come on. Yes. Tonight we'll celebrate.
Look at all this what I have.
I know, here. I can't eat. I've got to get back to him. Tonight we'll celebrate. Make sure Sophie gets home safe. Okay? I'm going to see you in those clothes tonight.
Look at this shoe!
Tonight.
And as for Meryl's reaction to the universal acclaim for her performance and for Sophie's Choice,
I'm always surprised at the way different people see different things, especially movies. Some people have railed against it. And most people have thought it was wonderful. That's what makes horse races.
Next time around, I'll have a review of Sophie's Choice. I'm Dino Lally.
Okay, there's fast, quick, rapid, and they all mean the same thing.
Swift, speedy,
hasty.
I want to say at the top, Sophie's Choice is a very good film. but it is also a very depressing movie that runs over 2 hours. And there are a couple of instances where you can feel that extra time because the film does drag in places. Sophie's Choice is an adaptation of William Styron's best-selling novel. And even though the film has its flaws and does not keep the same detail the book possesses, Sophie's Choice is still a very moving story. The year is 1947, the place, post-war Brooklyn. Meryl Streep plays Sophie, a Polish Catholic and a survivor of the concentration camps of World War II. She is a haunting beauty, seductive, innocent, and eerie. Her lover, Nathan Landau, is very well played by Kevin Klein. He's a Jewish intellectual and is prone to change from one personality to another at the drop of a hat. One minute he's excited and exuberant, the next minute he's beating Sophie, calling her names, and accusing her of sleeping around. A young, innocent, idealistic, and aspiring writer, Stingo, played by Peter McNichol, moves into the boarding house where Klein and Streep live. The three become the best of friends. In this scene, the three are just sitting around talking.
Yeah, to bloom, so what? I mean, this is a ridiculous language. There's too many words. The words for velocity. Okay, there's fast, quick, rapid. And they all mean the same thing.
Swift, speedy.
Hasty.
Fleet.
Brisk.
Expeditious.
Accelerated.
Winged.
No, stop it. It's ridiculous. Oh, in French, it's so easy. You say vite. Or in Polish, szybko. In Russian, bistro. It's only in the English. It's so complicated.
The three go on these small, fun trips together, yet there are times on these excursions that Klein turns on Streep and McNichol. He, in turn, comforts and consoles Streep. She then begins to reveal more of her background life to McNichol. And it's here we learn more and more about her. She has apparently lied about many things. Through a series of flashbacks, we learn of her pre-war life and incarceration by the Nazis. And it's in the latter half of those flashbacks that the movie loses some of its pace and direction. Although the flashbacks help to reveal more of Streep's character, it's almost too late and too disjointed. And ironically, it's also during this whole sequence where the film's action picks up. And we see the choice that Streep has to make upon arriving at a concentration camp. When the picture finally returns to the Brooklyn setting, the film does not have the same feeling. Meryl Streep as Sophie gives a superb performance. She is perfect for that mysterious role and proves it. You can feel her sense of hope, the pain from her past, the pain caused by Klein, her love for him, and her love of happiness. Klein is also tops in his changeable role of Nathan. He has his own secret of madness. You can feel his guilt, his hopes, and desires. And McNichol fits his character quite well, a naive and vulnerable man. He is at his best when listening and reacting to Sophie's deep, dark secrets. The three of them together make a strange trio, yet separately the characters are more interesting. On my rating scale, Sophie's Choice rates an 8. The film has many powerful moments, and yet it also has its slow points. It's hard not to react to the film's complicated emotional drama. You can feel the pain and anguish. You can feel the happiness and understanding. Sophie's Choice has many dark and mysterious sides to it, and yet even with those and its overall flaws, it's still a winner. I'm Dino Lally.
Hey, what is this?
It's Dino Picks the Flicks, all right. If you want to see an extremely serious film this weekend, then my first choice is Sophie's Choice. The adaptation of William Styron's best-selling novel is a depressing and emotional drama. It's also a long movie that runs over 2 hours, and at times, with the slow moments, you can feel those extra minutes. The story is about a young aspiring writer's relationship with a Polish Catholic and the man she loves. Sophie survived the horrors of concentration camps, but yet feels the pain and guilt they all created. Meryl Streep gives a remarkably seductive performance. Rated R, I give Sophie's Choice an 8. The Year of Living Dangerously is a sizzling adventure film starring Mel Gibson, Sigourney Weaver, and Linda Hunt. The romantic adventure is set in 1965 Indonesia during the rule of Sukarno and the turbulent times that ensued. This film also has its small problems, but it has a strong message, and I think it's worth your time and money. It's a different and strange film. Rated PG, I give it a 7. The Lords of Discipline stars David Keith as a cadet in his senior year at the Carolina Military Institute. He faces some hardcore tests of his honor and moral character as he tries to expose a secret hazing process at the institution. The language is rough in this one, thus an R rating. I'm rating it a 7. For some laughs, try to catch Lovesick. Dudley Moore and Elizabeth McGovern star in this cute romantic comedy. It's about a patient who falls in love with her analyst and vice versa.
I'm sorry, your time is up.
All right, I'm almost finished. Lovesick is rated PG and I give it a 6. For incredibly average movies, try The Entity and Sting 2. And that's it for now. I'll see you next week. I'm Dino Lally.
Why are
aren't you cooperating? Portraying the role of Ed Horman in Missing has brought Jack Lemmon his 8th Oscar nomination and a phenomenal 30-year career that has included 39 films. Based on the true story of a father's search for his son who disappears during a political coup in Chile in 1973, Lemmon's performance is one of the best of his career and a role he very much identified with.
I think the one thing that made it easier for me was the fact that I had a son in his 20s, as young Charles Horman was, and I didn't even have to think of how Ed Horman felt when suddenly he gets news that his son is missing, you know. I knew. I just knew. And especially the frustration of being unable to find any clue, any true fact as to what the hell is going on. And he's still missing.
Papers, you make out any kind of a release form, I will sign it. I will absolve anyone, everyone, of everything. I just want my boy back.
The difficulty is not portraying frustration, I don't think. The difficulty is only not to play the same thing, scene after scene after scene, but as the actor to find variances and different ways to portray 20 scenes in a row of frustration. You don't play each scene the same way, or you have, if you'll pardon the expression, a lemon on your hands, because it'll be dull.
Undoubtedly the most controversial film of the year, which includes raising the hackles of the State Department and several lawsuits, Missing was a success at the box office and has proven to be one of Jack Lemmon's fondest experiences.
I have not done, with all my good fortune, have been involved in any project that I cared more about and that I was more pleased with in its final result.
Tomorrow on Action 4, one of the best actress nominees, Jessica Lange, talks about her role in the film Frances. I'm Dino Lally.
And the most rewarding.
In 1974, Jessica Lange was just an acting student when she became aware of the tragic story of actress Frances Farmer. But from that moment, she was convinced that someday she would play that role. Ironically, 8 years later, in 1982, Jessica was selected to star in Frances, the film version of the tormented woman's life. Her portrayal has been honored as one of the year's best by an actress. For Jessica, it was an excruciating experience.
It was simultaneously the most hellish period of my life, and the most rewarding. Rewarding in the sense that I was able to really stretch my talents as far as possible. And frightening that the subject matter I was dealing with was just so overwhelmingly tragic most of the time.
You'd send me back.
You're going!
I'm not going anywhere.
You get out of my way! Get out of my way!
There were rumors after the film's production that said Jessica was difficult to work with on the set and that she caused a lot of problems. Well, she doesn't deny those rumors, saying playing such an emotional part carried over into her real life.
I tapped into almost a bottomless pit of rage of my own that had been stored up for years and years and years. And, it was a pain most of the time, a very painful experience. Because for me, anyhow, it's difficult to turn it on and turn it off, you know, like a faucet. It would bring up such tremendous emotion in me that it would kind of dictate my life for days or weeks or months. Even now, I find that she's still on my mind a lot of the time. It's not something I was able to do and just forget about. But it might be a character that stays with me for a lifetime.
Jessica Lange is competing with 4 other women for Best Actress, and on April 11th, we'll all find out who the winner is. I'm Dino Lally.
I'm planning long range. I'm going to loan you out to Sam Goldwyn. He's making a picture called Come and Get It.
I'm for you, Vern.
Big fun, Vern, at the Ernest P. Worrell annual only once a year fish fry. It's a tradition, Vern.
He's the one fast becoming a tradition in the world of TV commercials. For those who don't know, he's Ernest P. Worrell, redneck supremo, know what I mean? But you can't help but like him. For 11 months now, we've seen Ernest bug his next-door neighbor, Vern, always the eyes of the camera, telling him and us about the virtues of Braum's ice cream stores. Ernest in real life is a 33-year-old actor from Lexington, Kentucky, Jim Varney. And believe me, Varney, in playing the part of good old boy Ernest, is a natural.
Oh, natural, know what I mean? Hit me another little lick out of that jug.
Worm!
The people love Varney's portrayal of Ernest, and does he ever play to the camera?
Get the hat frame up and we'll get an awning effect. Like that. Yeah. Looks like a ship coming here.
Ernest's popularity hasn't really interfered with his occupation. He's a crossbreeder. What does Vernon think of all this popularity that you're getting?
Well, Vern doesn't know how to take it, really. See, Vern told me I'd never do anything with my crossbreeding. Which is my occupation, you know that, don't you?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I crossbreed small appliances with power tools. I have a crock pot sander and a chain toaster. If you're in the woods and you can't plug a toaster into a tree, so you just like that, a little bit of gasoline. They get kind of a smell to them like an oil pan, but it's crispy, it's good toast. Mm-hmm. It butters good, it just has that. I can't get the smell out of it. I'll get that out, though, next year.
You think there'll ever be a point in time when Vernon will actually enjoy seeing Vernon see Ernest come over?
Well, yeah, I'm hoping he will soon. He sees me on TV, you know, and all his ritzy friends like to hang out with me. Now that I'm a sex symbol, comprendo? Just let your buddy Ernest have a look at this. There's your problem, Vern, right there. See that little bitty old wire there? Looks like it might have a short in it. My daddy used to work on them.
Jim Varney is currently taking Ernest on the road for promotional tours. From Oklahoma City, it's on to Dallas, then back home to Nashville, where he does more than just ice cream commercials. In the meantime, he'll keep driving Vernon crazy. Dino Lolly, Action 4.
I will now perform Vernon the dance of the triple dip.
Look at it, Vernon. Look at it.
As a romantic comedy, Lovesick is another one of those cute movies. It's not great, but it isn't a complete waste of time either. The film has its little flaws and problems, but overall, Lovesick is a lovable and entertaining movie. Dudley Moore plays a happily married and well-adjusted psychiatrist, Saul Benjamin. He falls in love with one of his patients, Chloe Allen, a young playwright played by the adorably cute and delightful Elizabeth McGovern. Dudley Moore is not the first psychiatrist to fall in love with McGovern. Wallace Shawn is the first one, but because of technical difficulties, that situation never develops. McGovern is then referred to Dudley Moore, and on the first meeting, things begin to click. Moore becomes infatuated with her, which is easy to do. Now, when something like this happens in real life, by that I mean a patient falling in love with her analyst, and the analyst returning those feelings, it's known as countertransference. And also in real life, when countertransference occurs, there can be a lot of guilt and many times lawsuits. Dudley Moore is warned about the risk involved in countertransference by, first of all, the big guy of psychoanalysis himself, the spirit of Sigmund Freud, wonderfully portrayed by Alec Guinness. Moore is also warned by his own analyst and mentor, John Huston, and by a hard-nosed watchdog psychiatrist committee led by Alan King. Warning or not, Moore pursues McGovern. He has daydreams about her. He has fantasies. He conveniently steals her apartment key, sneaks in, and here in this scene is caught.
I'm taking a shower, Ted. Good night.
Hello.
Hello.
It's Dr. Benjamin.
Hi.
One of Elizabeth McGovern's problems is she suffers from anxiety attacks. Another one of her problems is her live-in, live-out semi-friend boyfriend, Ron Silver. He's the actor appearing as the lead in her play. Silver does a wonderful job as the grumpy, self-centered actor who explains his little temper fits by saying,
"Sometimes my instrument gets too keyed up."
And talk about vain, every time he walks by a mirror, he's just got to look at himself. Is the hair on straight? How about the tie? Huh? Everything look good? Huh? What? Oh, excuse me. We'll be back later. Lovesick has a good share of funny moments. Dudley Moore and Elizabeth McGovern are believable in their roles, as is everyone else. But I've got to say, Alec Guinness almost steals the whole picture as he appears now and then reading Variety and admitting to never hearing the term Freudian slip. On my rating scale, Lovesick rates a 6. A movie that could be viewed as cheap, Lovesick deals with a sensitive subject in a lighthearted and harmless manner. Even with its flaws, the movie in a roundabout way almost accomplishes something that analysis sometimes does itself, and that's make you feel good. And it can do that, as this is a charmingly funny movie. I'm Dino Lawley.